FSN Radio. It's all about what's next. Go to financialsurvivalnetwork.com and sign up for your free weekly newsletter. You'll also get three free reports. The Financial Survival Network. It's all about what's next.
Welcome. You are listening to the Financial Survival Network. I'm Kerry Lutz. It's July 6th, 2017. One of my fondest memories of a trip that I took to California, to the People's Republic of California, I had an appointment and it was way north of LA, I guess a little east. And all of a sudden I see these signs after the appointment was over, Reagan Library. So I said, I got to check this out. And I drove over there. It was about 15 minutes from where my appointment was. And it was one of the most memorable events, one of the most fun events, touching, profound experiences I ever had in my numerous trips to California. And right now we are really fortunate to have on the Ronald Reagan Presidential Foundation and Institute's Executive Director, John Hybush. John, welcome to the show.
Hey, great to be with you, Kerry.
Hey, so, you know, we think presidents kind of go and we build these libraries and, you know, there are a lot of times they're glorifications or, you know, they cut out the negative and all that. But the Reagan Library is different than that, isn't it?
Yeah, it's at first it's the largest, it's the most successful, it's the most visited of all the presidential libraries, and it's well over 250,000 square feet, and it's a lot of room, but we think not enough room to be able to showcase the life of one of the country's most magnificent presidents. That's who President Reagan was, and we cover his lifetime from birth till death and afterwards, and show, you know, what an incredible vision this man had for his country and how he worked his life away to try to make that vision a reality.
Yeah, and he was really a servant. And obviously the topic of our conversation isn't really the Reagan Library per se, but if you have an opportunity, if you're out in California, I think it is one of the most, and regardless what your political leanings might be, it is one of the most fascinating and inspiring and touching experiences that you're ever going to have. And since you're in a position of having known Reagan and what he was about, your recent article in the Daily Caller, particularly relevant right now. Basically, you're drawing parallels between President Reagan and President Trump in certain key ways. How are they similar?
Well, first let me start on the similarity front. I've no doubt, while President Trump is experiencing a lot of heat, he's under a great deal of criticism in his first 6 months. There's no doubt he loves the country, and I know he has its best interests in mind. President Reagan, too, faced a lot of heat in his first couple of years in office. A lot of skeptics and a lot of critics came out of the woodwork to do everything they could to stop him. So there's real parallels in that regard. I think it's great as a fan of President Reagan's to see President Trump almost by the day take one page or another out of President Reagan's playbook. They have very similar philosophies as it relates to the need for smaller government and less taxes and more freedom and a stronger defense. And so in that regard, the two men stand quite alike. They're very, very different as it relates to their personalities, their styles, and how they communicate. But they're both bent their lives on something very important, and that's a strong America and a prosperous America. So I think that's what we see.
Hey, and you know, one thing they really have in common, they both were successful in the media. Obviously, Reagan as spokesman radio show for GE, where he really was a missionary for capitalism and democracy and citizen involvement in government. And then, of course, his storied movie career. And then we look at Trump. Now, granted, reality TV, a little bit different, but he did have thousands of interviews where he was really boosting America and encouraging the country to do better than it was on many fronts. So where he didn't have a formal soapbox like President Reagan did. He really did have a lot of exposure where he almost made the shows, other people's shows, his show, if you will. Right?
Yeah. Yeah. I think that's you've done a fine description. That's, you're right. They, two men living in very different times who took advantage of the various mediums at their disposal at the time. And so President Reagan, in the 1980s, we had the first fax machines, obviously no internet and three networks and a cable TV station and a lot of snail mail. Of course, we had radio and But that was about it. And then Donald Trump, whether it be the star of The Apprentice or the very many media interviews that you've noted he's done, he lives in a time when, at a push of a few thumbs, he's able to reach tens of millions of people without a filter and through a communications channel called the Twitter and many other ways we didn't have during the Reagan days. And I think both were reflective of their times. They were master communicators. President Trump is a master communicator, and they just use the various mediums available to them at the time to be as effective as they can.
Hey, and I can just remember Reagan giving speeches, and the man knew how to look into the camera and talk directly to you. And the only one who ever came anywhere near as close as he did, and I didn't even think he was really that close, but the best of subsequent presidents since Ronald Reagan was Bill Clinton. He had the stage presence, if you will, to some extent, not as professional and as sincere, perhaps, but he was able to connect with you on the screen. And that was pretty amazing that people can do that, Reagan could do it, and it was so natural. I mean, it didn't feel staged. It wasn't like Nixon getting on the stage of the platform and very uncomfortably looking into the camera. I mean, it was so natural and so sincere and genuine.
Yeah, I've always thought that when people made comparisons of President Reagan and Clinton in the past, you couldn't find two individuals more different in so many ways. But President Reagan was an actor, he had all those skills one expects to see in a great actor: a sense of timing and sense of humor and the ability to when to use your, voice inflection a certain way. And I think those skills he knew as he mastered them would be extremely important in the world of politics. They were skills that helped paint a vision for people as he spoke, and he used them to his great advantage. And I think someone like President Clinton was not an actor. He was a life's natural politician. And so he, had this natural magnet. Essentially a magnetism that drew people to him. And what he tried to do was take that natural skill as a politician to the point of being an actor trying to, essentially on the opposite end of President Reagan, trying to use those skills to reach people as a politician. And maybe that might say the two kind of met in the middle. At the end of the day, my love and admiration for President Reagan far exceeds that of President Clinton, because I think President Reagan had nothing but sincerity in how he used the skills that he had to better his country. And I think that President Clinton, so much of it was just purely political. And it he had a very different vision for the country than President Reagan. And,
oh, yes.
I don't see that his skills took the country too far.
Yeah, yeah. But he was a very, whatever you might think about him, he was a very talented person. And whether he was on the dark side or not, we'll kind of have to let history be the judge, right? But he was a natural at this. He really was able to connect with people on a pretty deep level, just in ways similar to President Reagan, of course. So
yeah, I'd say he was a naturally gifted politician. Whether he was a great leader is a whole nother question.
Well, like I said, we'll leave that for history to figure out. Certainly, the point is well taken that he had his own agenda, and whether or not that was for the good of the country, like I said, history will be the judge. You and I have our own opinions about it, as does everyone. But, you know, in his defense, the country appeared to be doing well under his stewardship, whether that was illusory or whether it was real, like I say. But now we go back to Trump. So also, so many of you don't remember that Reagan was pilloried by the press. He was always, like Sam Donaldson, belittled his intellect. All the reporters were totally against him. And yet, he could talk through the media directly to the American public. And that's something that him and Trump both have the ability to do. Like his tweets or hate them, think they're unpresidential. Personally, I enjoy them and I find them entertaining. They both are able to do that. And that's something that you can't teach as well.
Yeah, I agree. It's not something to be taught. I do think you're right about the fact that President Reagan, he surely had to be talented because the mediums that he spoke through were really not in his control. I mean, he had to rely on network coverage and radio and print to get his message across. It meant he had to be especially convincing in order to get them to help carry his message and eventually his vision. In the modern day, with the internet, the World Wide Web, and everyone on the planet, it seems, having their own communications device and able to receive video and photos and texts and 140-character tweets in the blink of an eye. President Trump has quite an advantage at his disposal. He's got no filters if he chooses to not want them.
That's part of the problem.
And so, he's able to reach tens of millions of people without having to, go through a filter of networks like President Reagan did. So much more strength and power in the way you're able to communicate today than we were during President Reagan's time.
Yeah, of course, technology is really the great equalizer. If you look at the evolution of technology, John, from the Wild West, the Colt 45 was the great equalizer. It made the small man equal to the big man. And it's continued from that point onward to equalize, to play down the advantages of the power elite in many regards, right? You see it over and over again in current American politics. Technology has given the citizen journalist the ability to reach as many people as the elite journalists. So really, in a way, Trump has it easier than Ronald Reagan, like you alluded to.
Yeah, I think you're right. It's this technology has empowered everyone, and I mean everyone, to essentially have an equal voice. And the question remains whether or not, as everyone's been empowered, is every single opinion worth broadcasting? Is every single opinion formulated well enough or smart enough or close enough to the truth that it deserves the kind of attention it gets? That's still certainly an open question in today's society, and then one that we're going to be wrestling with for some time.
Yeah. And so what is your feeling? All these advances in technology, there's always two sides to every advance, right? Positive, negative. Where are we here with this? Are we getting better as a society because of this, or is it a distinct negative?
Yeah, I think the penultimate question for this early part of the century. It's does this technology unite or divide us? That's the question, and I think it does both. I think we take the good with the bad, and I think it's improved every person's ability to reach out and to touch others and to communicate and to be part of groups and to belong and to associate and affiliate with like-minded people. I think it gives them reason to think and to exist and to enjoy their lives. And I think that's all just an absolutely terrific thing. And at the same time, with so many people participating in, through the use of this technology, something else it's done is I think it's sped up our lives. And it's created a certain intensity with so many people being involved. And, people's voices are amplified now far more so than they ever were before. And so there's a lot of noise in the system, too. And so picking out, through all that noise, what's meaningful to listen to and what's not, and, what's backed up by facts and what's not. And, it takes more than the object or the gadget in your hand to be smart. You can be communicated to all day long, but what you do with that information and you know how you relay it to others is really absolutely critical for us to succeed as a nation united for all. You know, so I guess mm-hmm. you know, as I say, that it has this technology has incredible benefits, but it also places responsibility on all of us to use it to not just to our best advantage as individuals, but for our society as well.
Yeah, I think your point is extremely well taken there. And it's going to continue to evolve, and we're going to continue to really discover limitations and the negative side of what it is we're doing here. So if Reagan, I know this is a bit of a stretch, but if Ronald Reagan were alive today and was witnessing the presidency of Donald Trump, what do you think he would say? I mean, you knew the man. How would he be reacting to this?
I think from the standpoint of philosophy and vision, he'd be supportive of what President Trump is trying to do, you know, because I think President Trump is trying to replicate a lot of the vision that President Reagan was so successful with in the 1980s. I do think President Trump wants to see President Reagan's ideals that, whether he attributes them to President Reagan or not, of smaller government and less regulation, less taxes and more freedom and a stronger defense. I think he wants those same things. So I think generally speaking, President Reagan would find real favor in the type of agenda, broad agenda that President Trump is trying to put in place. As to specifics, how would President Reagan feel about President Trump's willingness to remove us from the Paris Accords and, you know, mm-hmm. specific questions like that, that's far, far more difficult to handicap because, times have changed and in every little situation from then till now is different. And, it's just really hard to determine exactly how President Reagan would feel about something. But generally speaking, I think he'd be supportive of the Trump agenda.
Yeah, it's interesting just to speculate and think about it. Obviously, we'll never know. But and you've recently written a book. Tell us about it.
Yeah, well, it's a little unusual for me to be writing a book. I've my whole career has been spent in politics and business and the nonprofit space. And I've written many, many things in my life, speeches and introductions of famous people and opinion pieces for the Times and the Journal and places like that. But I never thought I had the stamina or patience to do what every American seems to want to do. And, you know, that's write the great American novel. And so I sat down one night a few years ago and started on chapter one. And before I knew it, I was on chapter 43. And the book, it's a fiction thriller called The Shroud Conspiracy. It's on mm-hmm. several bestseller lists already. Just came out several weeks ago. The Today Show is called it one of the best reads for the summer. So it's doing really well. And, you know, for your listeners, I know if they're looking for a really enjoyable, fun-filled book to, a thriller to read for this summer, I think The Shroud Conspiracy might be it.
All right. Well, we will definitely take a look at it and want to thank you for coming on the show and sharing your experiences with us and your wisdom. And of course, we wish you the best on the book. If you got any questions for John or myself, don't hesitate to email us at kl@carrylutz.com. Remember our site, financialsurvivalnetwork.com. Sign up for a free newsletter going out today. And the Twitter feed's @CarrieLutz. The Facebook page is Financial Survival Network. John, we wish you the best of luck on your recent attempt at authorship and hope it all goes well for you. Keep up the great work at the library as well, because it really is a national treasure that I encourage you to really visit and really experience for yourself. It's so important to understand history. And the beauty of that library is, John, that it makes you feel like you're there living through history with the president.
Yeah. I think you're right about that, Carrie. And I really appreciate the time spent with you.
Likewise. Hey, good luck, John. Thanks so much.
You too.
FSN Radio. It's all about what's next. Go to financialsurvivalnetwork.com and sign up for your free weekly newsletter. You'll also get three free reports. The Financial Survival Network. It's all about what's next.